myself Dr. Vaidhi Rohan Sukri, Assistant Professor, Department of Botany, Yashwant Rao Chauhan Institute of Science. Now we are going to study plant growth and different plant growth regulators. First, we should know what is the definition of the plant growth. Here, the permanent and irreversible change in mass, weight or volume of living organism, organ or cell. The plant growth is the permanent and irreversible change in mass, in weight or volume. That is, the change should not be temporary. Example, in rainy season the wooden doors get swell due to they absorb the rainwater, but in summer season automatically they comes under their normal condition. Can we say that the plant growth, the growth of that wooden door? No, this is the temporary change, but growth is the permanent change. Growth is the permanent change and this is the irreversible change. In what factors irreversible change? In what factors permanent? So permanent and irreversible change in mass, weight or the volume of living organism or organ or the cell. Okay, next, the phases of growth. The phases of growth are: first phase is phase of cell division, phase of cell enlargement and phase of cell maturation. In the phase of cell division, first the cell divide mitotically to form the two cells. In that two cell or both the cells, both the daughter cells again enlarges in size by doubling or increasing their internal matter, also doubling of the genetic material, the other cellular organelles. At the center there is a formation of the vacuole and all that pressure goes on the cell wall, and so the again there is a deposition of material on the cell wall, deposition of cementing material on the cell wall, so the cell wall become enlarged. Okay, and then the cell become mature, and that two mature cells, in that two mature cell, one of that two cells goes to the permanent to form the component of different type of the tissue, and the one cell which again goes to the division. Okay, in this process there is a first cell division. This is the first phase of the growth of the plant, that is the phase of cell division. Second is cell enlargement. After cell division there is a enlargement of cell by addition of the cellular material, by creation of the vacuole at the center. And third is the phase of cell mature. Here the cell get fully matured and one of the cell goes to the again division and one of the cell goes to the permanent. Next, we can see these three growth phases again in the root tip. If we see the diagram of the root tip, there is, this is the region of cell division. In this region there are number of cells which are meristematic cells, and meristematic cells are highly active. They having abundant material, full of material, they are highly active and capable of division. And so there is a continuously division of the cell takes place in the zone of cell division, and that zone is very sensitive because there is a continuously division of the cell, and so that region is protected by the root cap. And this zone of cell division is again followed by the zone of cell elongation. The cells which are formed in that region, which elongates in the zone of cell elongation, like by addition of the cellular material, addition of vacuole and other cellular organelles, etc. And this zone is again followed by the cell differentiation zone. This zone is again called as, or also called as, cell maturation zone. And in that maturation zone, the all the cells get fully matured. And this zone also shows the root hair cell. So in the root cap, this zone is also called as the root hair zone. So in this way, this root tip shows three types of zone. The first zone is the zone of cell division. The second zone is the zone of cell elongation. And the third zone is the zone of cell differentiation. And these are also the phases of the plant growth. Growth curve and grand period of growth. First, we should know that here, what is the growth curve? Before going to the definition, first, we take here the some examples. This is the one example regarding the cell. Here, regarding the organ of a plant, example leaf, and here a organism or example of herbaceous plant. In case of the cell, first there is a cell division, and in cell division, this is a slow process, and that process or that phase is called as the lag phase. This takes a little time, and then after cell division, that with the cells which are newly formed, that which there is an increase in size, there is an elongation of cells, and this process is very very fast, and that phase is called as the log phase, or this is also called as the exponential phase. And after that, that cells become fully mature. That cells become fully mature, and that phase is called as the stationary phase. The cells, they complete their work, and they again get killed or die or get disappear. That is, there is a death of that cells occur. So in this example, that life cycle of cell shows lag phase, log phase, and the stationary phase, and after that there is a death of that cell occur. In second example, that is the organ of the cell, we take here organ leaf. When the leaf emerges from a bud or from the shoot or the stem, the growth of that leaf is very very slow, and this comes up, that phase of the leaf comes under the lag phase. Then after completion of the lag phase, there is a rapid increase in the growth of that leaf. This comes under the log phase or the exponential phase. The leaf lamina get increased in size very fast, and after that the leaf comes in the stationary phase. In the stationary phase, the leaf become fully mature, and when the function of leaf get over, it become dry, it become yellowish dry, and then it get dark. Okay, that is, this is the, there is a death of that leaf or death of that organ. That is, the life cycle of that leaf is also shows lag phase, log phase, and the stationary phase. And third example is herbaceous plant. During the seed germination, the dry weight of that plant or that part is very very less. This comes under the lag phase. Then there is a fast growth of that herbaceous plant, this is seedling, and that fast growth, this phase, is comes under the log phase or the exponential phase, and then that plant becomes fully mature. And when it completes its life cycle, it becomes bad. When it becomes completely mature, the vegetative period is over, the reproductive period is over, then it becomes stable and start to die. So in this case, in the all the example, there is a lag phase, log phase and the stationary phase. Okay, if we see here the graph, all that volume or weight or dry weight are when compared with the time period, then we get here the graph in the form of S-shaped sigmoid curve, lag phase, log phase and the stationary phase, S-shaped sigmoid curve. Okay, and that curve is called as growth curve. That is here growth curve, which shows three phases: lag phase, log phase, stationary phase. Lag phase is slow here, log phase is very fast, and stationary phase is also called as the steady phase. Log phase here also called as the exponential phase. Then what about the grand period of growth? Grand period of growth is that period where there is a maximum growth is occur. The maximum growth of cell occurs at the log phase. The maximum growth of the leaf occurs at the log phase again. And maximum growth of the seedling or the herbaceous plants again occurs at the log. So the grand period of growth is the is this phase, that is the log phase. Okay. Then we are coming to the plant growth regulators. Okay. Are the plant growth regulators are nutrients or any another substance? No. These are not nutrients, but these are very very essential for the growth of plant. Okay, then what is the definition of plant growth regulators? Okay, the plant growth regulators is defined as a substance other than nutrients which is in very small quantity initiates, inhibit, promote or otherwise modifies any physiological process in plants. Okay, that is the plant growth regulators, which are the substances. These are not the nutrients. Okay, these substances are not nutrients. These substances are essential in very small quantity by the plants. These components which having the ability to initiate, to inhibit, to promote or also modify any physiological process. That is, they can initiate any physiological process or initiate any biochemical process. They can inhibit also any biochemical process. They can modify or promote any biochemical process or the physiological process in the plant. One again important characteristic of the plant growth hormone is that plant growth hormones which synthesized at the one side and they are transferred or transferred at the another side where they are needed. That is the site of action. This is very very important characteristic of the plant growth regulator. So the phytohormone of the plant growth regulator is also defined as a growth regulator produced in plants which in low concentration regulates plant physiological process and moves within the plant from site of production to site of action. There are five types of plant growth regulators. First, auxin. Second, cytokinin, gibberellin, abscisic acid and ethidine. We see here plant growth regulators one by one. First, auxin. The auxin is discovered by F.W. Penn. There are number of important auxins. Here some examples: indole 3 acetic acid, indole 3 propionic acid, indole 3 pyruvic acid, indole 3 ब्यूटेरिक एसिड एंड नैथॉक्सी एसिटिक एसिड. इन ऑल द इंडोल्फी एसिटिक एसिड इज अ नेचुरली ऑकरिंग ऑक्सीजन विच इज नेचुरली ऑकरिंग इन द प्लांट एंड अदर्स आर केमिकली प्रिपेयर्ड आर्टिफिशियली प्रिपेयर्ड ऑक्सीजन. देर आर सम प्रैक्टिकल एप्लीकेशन ऑफ द ऑक्सीजन. फर्स्ट इज सेल इलॉन्गेशन, लॉन्जिट्यूडिनल ग्रोथ एंड द सेल डिविजन. वी नो दैट इन द प्लांट ग्रोथ और प्लांट ग्रोथ डज नॉट टेक्स प्लेस विदाउट सेल डिविजन, विदाउट सेल इलॉन्गेशन एंड विदाउट लॉन्जिट्यूडिनल ग्रोथ. ओके, बट हियर द ऑक्सीजन विच आर वेरी वेरी इम्पॉर्टेंट रोल प्लेस इन सेल डिविजन एंड द सेल इलॉन्गेशन. And so, due to the oxygen, there is a automatically growth of the plant tissues. In case of cell division, the oxygens are also used in the tissue culture media. Because in the tissue culture media, for the callus formation, the cell division should be fast. And for the fast cell division, the oxygens are added into the tissue culture media. The next is the root formation. The auxin which prevent the elongation of the root, but it proliferate the lateral branches or the lateral buds to the root. So in case of cuttings, like the cuttings of the roots, cuttings of the grapes branches, there is a very very auxin plays very important role. Next is the prevention of abscission layer. Abscission layer is the layer which is formed at the basis of petioles, at the basis of pedicel and the peduncle also. And due to the abscission layer, formation of abscission layer, the fruits or the flowers or the fruits follow. Okay, so oxygen plays very important role in the prevention of abscission layer. So there is a delay in the falling of that all the fruits, leaves and the flowers also. Next is the effect of flowering. The auxin also effect on the flowering. The auxin can delay the period of the vegetative growth. And so we can delay the period of the reproductive growth and the flowering period. So auxin is very essential role plays into the flowers. Then the spur formation. Here also auxin plays a role into the elongation of the shoot. Elongation of the shoot. Here when we cut the shoot, then there is a proliferation of the short branches or the lateral branches. In case of apple and the pear, there are two types of the branches. Branches of limited growth and the branches of unlimited growth. And the flowers are also on the branches of limited growth. So, there is a limited growth branches are very important. And by using that application of the auxin, we can proliferate the number of limited branches on that plant and we can increase the yield of that plant. Next is the parthenocarpic fruit development. This is again very important application of the auxin. What is mean by the parthenocarpic fruit? First, we know that after successful pollination and the fertilization, there is a fruit formation. But that fruit contains the number of seeds. But when the fruit formation is without the fertilization, when fruit formation occurs without fertilization, formed without fertilization, then that fruit do not contain seeds. That type of fruit is called as parthenocarpic fruit. And auxin, which plays important role in parthenocarpic fruit development. Then the eradication of weeds. There are some weeds which are very sensitive to the auxin. Their roots are very, very sensitive to the oxygen. We know that weeds are, these are the unwanted plants. These are the harmful plants to our crops. And when we use the oxygen to treat their roots, then they weeds automatically get that, and we can increase the yield of our crop. And the last application of the oxygen is prevention of lodging. Here, lodging means fodder. In some poison manures, the stem of that plants are very, very weak, and due to this they get fodder or they show the lodge or the lodge. Okay, but when we treated that plants with the oxygen, then the stem of that plant become semi, and so that there is a prevention of lodging, which is very, very essential to increase our crop productivity. Then the next hormone is gibberellin. The gibberellin hormone, which is the gibberellin hormone, which is discovered by the Japanese plant pathologist Kurosa. Okay, there are again some practical applications of the gibberellin. First is the stem elongation. So gibberellin, which very important role plays in the stem elongation. So due to the stem elongation, there is automatically growth of the plant takes. If we see here practical example, then in the sugarcane, the elongation of stem is very, very important. As the stem elongates, there is a increase in the yield of the sugarcane. So stem elongation is very important practical application of the gibberellin. Next is the reversal of genetic dwarfism. So gibberellin having capacity to reverse the dwarfism. That is, here gibberellin having capacity to convert the dwarf plant into the tall plant. That is, we convert the dwarf plant into the tall plant by using the gibberellin treatment with that plants. Then bolting and flower. Here, what is mean by the bolting? Bolting in some annual and the biennial plants or the angiosperm, there is a formation of the rosette of leaves due to the shortened intervals in the first season. And then in second year or the second season, there is an elongation of the intervals. Then the leaves become separate from each other, and then the flowering occurs on that plant. Okay, this is called as the bolting. But that bolting we can reduce by using the gibberellin treatment. That is, in the same season we can produce flowers on the same plant. Okay, next is the promotion of seed germination. Okay, when the seed comes under the dormant condition of the dormant seeds which are failed to germinate, we can promote that dormant seed to germinate by using the gibberellin treatment. Some seed when complete the rainy season or the cold, they are exposed to the cold treatment, then only they are capable for the germination. But when that type of the seeds are exposed to the gibberellin, then they are having the capacity of the germinate. That is, here gibberellin, which we use in the promotion of the seed germination. Next, substituting cold treatment and the flowering induction. Some winter varieties plant which after completion of the winter season, that is the after completion of the cold treatment, they shows the flowering. But in that type of the plants, when we expose that plant or when we create the gibberellin to that plant, when the plants are gibberelling treatment given to this plant, then the plant directly produces the flowers or shows the flowering without any cold treatment or without any winter season or the rainy season. Then reversion of the sex expression. This is again one important application of the gibberelling. Here, gibberelling having the capacity to reverse the sex expression. That is, if gibberelling treated to the male plants, then the number of female flowers can be increased on that. And when these are gibberelling treatment is given to the female plants, then the number of male flowers can be increased on that plant. This is the reversion of sex expression. Okay, in some plants we need number of fruits, number of flowers. Okay, at that time we can increase the number of flowers on that plant by using the gibberelling treatment. And last is the parthenotherapy. Again, like the auxin, gibberelling, which also shows the one important application, that is the parthenotherapy. Again, here parthenotherapy fruit means seedless fruit, that fruit is formed without fertilization. Okay, and that type of fruit also we can produce by using the gibberelling treatment. Next, there is a cytokine. This is the third plant growth hormone, cytokine. And that cytokine is discovered by Haberlin. There are again some practical applications of the cytokine. First is cell division, cell enlargement and organ formation. So again here, cell division is very, very important. We know that plant growth do not take place without cell division, without cell enlargement. And after cell division, after cell enlargement, there is a formation of tissues, there is a formation of organs like the root, stem, leaves, flowers, fruits, etc. Okay, that is cytokine, again very, very important in the plant growth. Also important in the organ formation in the plants. Okay, next application of that cytokine is conversion of apical dominance. Here, cytokine which is used in conversion of apical dominance. What is mean by the conversion of apical dominance? When apical bird shows the dominance, it prevents the production of the lateral buds. It prevents the growth of the lateral buds. Okay, and when the plants are treated with the cytokine, the plants will show the number of lateral buds, because we have cytokine which increases the vascular supply to the lateral buds. So there is a growth of the lateral buds. This is the conversion of apical dominance. Next is the breaking of seed dormancy. The seed dormancy gets break. That is, there is a promotion of seed germination again by using the cytokine treatment. Next, delaying senescence. Okay, we know that when senescence is occurred, when there is a falling of fruits, when there is a falling of flowers, when there is a falling of leaves also. Okay, when there is an abscission layer formed at the base of the petiole, at the base of the pedicel or at the base of the petiole, there is a, then there is a falling of that leaves, flowers, fruits, etc. Okay, but when we when that cell is having the concentration of the cytokine, then there is a no formation of the abscission layer and the senescence of that organs automatically begin. Then promotion of chloroplast. Promotion of chloroplast is very, very essential in the calyx, in the tissue culture technique. When we process the plants by tissue culture technique, then that callus is, or the cells of that callus, which shows the etioplast, which are colorless. And that etioplast are converted into the chloroplast by cytokine. So in tissue culture media, like the policy of zinc, cytokinin is very, very important, which promote the chloroplast in that callus. The next phytohormone is the abscisic acid. Actually, this abscisic acid is called as the inhibitor of the growth. Why? First, abscisic acid discovered by the Lee and Kings in 1957. If you see the application, various applications of the abscisic acid, it inhibits the seed germination. Okay, the other phytohormones of seed, gibberellins, and the cytochrome, which promote the seed germination. And here, that abscisic acid, that is the APA, which inhibit the seed germination. It also inhibit the seedling growth. So this is also called as the inhibitor of the plant growth. It shows the abscission and the senescence. That is other phytohormones which prevent the abscission layer. And here the abscisic acid, which is useful in the production of ethylene, it helps in the formation of the abscission layer at the basis of petiole, pedicel and the peduncle. Okay, so due to the formation of the abscission layer, the cells at the abscission layer get softened and automatically there is a falling of leaves, fruit, flowers, etc. Automatically there is a senescence of that organs. Next is the fruit growth and the ripening. But abscisic acid is very essential in the fruit growth and the ripening. It is essential in fruit growth, but also it is also essential in converting the unripened fruit into the ripened fruit, because it is very, very important hormone in the production of ethylene hormone, which is very, very important for the ripening of the fruits. And last is the stomata, stomatal closing. When guard cells of the stomata shows uptake of the potassium, then the stomata get open. But that ABA, when there is a presence of ABA in the cells or in the guard cells or in the stomatic cells, they prevent the uptake of potassium by that guard cell, and so that stomata automatically get closed. And the last phytohormone is ethylene. The ethylene is discovered by Denny in 1924. There are some practical applications of ethylene. Again, first is the ripening of fruit. As I said, the ethylene is very, very important in the ripening of fruit. Firstly, it was considered that the ripened fruit, which emits some volatile substance, and due to that volatile substance, the other unripened fruit get ripened. And after that, it discovered that volatile substance is the ethylene. So ethylene is very, very important in the ripening of the fruit. Second is the geotropism. The plants which are horizontally placed, the roots of that get bent and downside. And this is due to the presence of oxygen. But later it is discovered that oxygen helps in the production of the ethylene also. So due to the presence of ethylene at the lower side, there is, or that plant shows the geotropism, or they bend towards the earth on the side. And last is the apical dominance. That ethylene also shows the apical dominance. That is, it also prevents the proliferation of the lateral buds of the lateral branches. There are again some important changes during the ripening. The first important change during the ripening, we know that ethylene is very, very important in the fruit ripening process. Then what type of changes takes place during the ripening process? First change is the softening of the fruit tissue. Here in the unripened fruit, the tissue is not very soft, but during the ripening of the fruit, that tissue get soft. Okay, and this change takes place only due to that ethylene. Then there is a hydrolytic changes, that is a conservation of food material. Okay, in the mesophyll cells of the unripened fruit, there is a various organic acids and the various other substances other than sugars are present. Okay, but during the ripening process, that substances get converted into the various or different types of the sugars. Okay, and this process is this process takes time different in different types of the plants. Like in banana, the ripening of banana is very very fast process. This process in banana is very fast. This process in apple, in case of apple, this process is one. And in case of citrus, this process is very 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 slow. And so that citrus fruits do not show ripening process fastly. Okay, and the last is changes in pigments and flavors. Okay, we know that unripened the fruits are green in color. That is, there is a chloroplast in that unripened fruit. The cell wall or the upper wall, the upper covering of that fruit is green in color. That is, this shows or this contains the chloroplast in it. But during the ripening process, that chloroplast get converted into different types of the carotenoids, different colors, different types of the colored pigments, carotenoids. Okay, example, in a tomato, the green fruit get converted into the red. Green color get converted into the red. In citrus, the green color converted into the yellow color, and in orange, the green color get converted into the orange color. That is, here during the ripening process, the green color get converted into the red color or yellow color or orange color. And also during the ripening process, it shows the or it produces the different types of the flavors. Different types of the flavors also. During the hydrolytic changes, due to the conversion of the food material, due to the conversion of different organic acids and the substances into the different types of the sugars, that is, their sour taste get converted into the sweet taste. In this way, there are three types of the important changes during the ripening process. First is softening of fruit tissue, second is hydrolytic changes, that is conversion of food material, and third is changes in pigment and flavor. Thank you.
Last slide for the video.